Let's go to God real quick. All right, Heavenly Father, we just come to you. We thank you for this beautiful, beautiful day that you've given to us. Even though many of us were stuck in school far too long today, we just thank you for your love for each and every single one of us. We thank you, Father, for the chance to come here tonight. We have the freedom to do that. We thank you for some great friends and just silly things that we can do, having fun, playing Nerf Wars, just having a whole lot of fun and some fellowship here in a building, God, that you have blessed us with. I thank you for each of these students that are here tonight. God, they could be doing almost anything anywhere here in town. They chose to be here, so I pray for a blessing upon them. All right. Father, I just ask that you would be here tonight, Holy Spirit, just fill this room, fill each one of us. I just pray that you would speak, that you would move tonight according to your plan, according to your will. Help us just to focus on you and you alone for these next few short minutes. We give this time to you for your kingdom and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so let me get this back off so you can actually see what's going to get up here. Alright, we are starting a brand new series tonight. Alright, brand new series. We're going to look at the next 6 weeks. We're going to look at some tough questions. Questions that that I remember being asked when I was your age. Right? Questions that you've probably been asked if your faith is known to people. Right? If you claim to be a Christian in front of other people who are not Christians, you've probably heard some of these questions. I'm not going to go through all of them tonight, right? But we're going to take the next 6 weeks and we're going to talk about some questions, right, that you should be faced with from people around you, and why we need to know the answers to these and how important they are in sharing our faith with the people around us. Right? So we're going to look at six tough questions over the next 6 weeks. Okay, skip through that. All right. I really like this picture. I was going to make this picture the theme one, but I just didn't have the title in it. Tina and I both really like this picture. Okay, but when you're asked questions, especially when it comes to questions about the Bible, questions about your faith, okay, a lot of times there's simple answers like this, like yes, no, maybe. You ever say, you know, I just don't know. It's okay to say, I don't know, when it comes to questions about the Bible. But that means you need to do a little bit of work. Alright? But here's the thing. Do you ever hear yourself saying, you know what, I really don't care? When it comes to something about Scripture, when it comes to something about your faith, that you honestly don't know the answer to. You say, you know what, I honestly really don't care. And you say, you know what, I need to find the answer after that. Okay? So that's what I want you to ask yourself as we kind of start this series. Do you really want to grow and your faith, and your knowledge about the Scriptures, and your knowledge about God Himself? Because that's what these next 6 weeks are honestly really going to be about. Not just answering questions, but a chance to grow and learn more and grow closer to God through this. Okay? So, tonight we're going to look at the number one question that I remember being asked, a question that's all over the place today. Right? When it comes to being someone who follows Christ and Christ alone, people ask, is Jesus really the only way to get to heaven? Alright? You guys, when you're in school, do you hear anything? You guys ever talk about this kind of stuff? Do you hear people saying, you know, I really don't believe that the Bible is the only truth that's out there? Do you have other people say, you know, I believe that this way is acceptable as well? Do you guys get that kind of stuff at school? Alright? Well, I mean, if you met some of your friends and you said, how do you get to heaven, what do you think some of your answers would be? Shout some things back at me.
Go to church. There isn't one.
Okay, there isn't one. Okay. Just go to church. It's okay. That's a big belief, honestly. Unfortunately, that's wrong. But there's a lot of people who believe just going to church is okay. What else do you think your friends would say?
Being baptized.
Okay, being baptized. Alright.
Being a good person.
Being a good person. I do more good than I do bad, and that should get me into heaven. Right? That's
being free of sin.
Okay. Okay, being free from sin, can we honestly ever be free from it?
Having lots of money.
Okay, there are some people that honestly do believe they can buy a spot in heaven. By giving money to the church, they can secure a place for themselves, or maybe secure a place for a relative who's passed on. I can buy their way into heaven, right? All those are honestly answers that I have heard, and I have heard many, many, many times. Plus, there's obviously many more. There are some people that believe that the God of every religion is really the same God, just with a different name. Right? So no matter what you believe, as long as you believe sincerely with it, you're going to get there. Right? There's a lot of different things that are out there in this world today that say, this is how you get to heaven. There are a lot of people that think, I have to work my way. I have to do things. I have to sacrifice myself for other people. And that will get me rewards with God and allow me to get into heaven. Right? And the scripture obviously is completely different from what that says. We're going to be looking at John 14. Before we get to that, I think it's really, really key that before we read this passage, we have to look at the background. What is leading up to this specific section? Why Jesus says these things? Right? Why he says these here in John 14? Okay? At this point, Jesus knows his earthly ministry is getting ready to come to a close. Okay? He's talking with his disciples. Right? He knows the Jewish religious leaders of that time, he knows they have a lot of power. And they're going to use that power and abuse that power to have him arrested. He knows that. Right? Even though they had a court system, right? The Roman people said, you know what, you're Jewish, you guys handle it. We don't honestly really care. So a lot of times those religious leaders would use that power to make influence in their courts and over the people in the wrong way. And Jesus knew that, and he was confronting that. And he's talking to his disciples at this time. Basically, he's sharing the Last Supper with them. Right? You guys see that there? He's sharing the Last Supper. He's sharing the Last Supper with these guys. Alright? He tells them about the betrayal that's going to happen. He specifically tells them, I'm going to be betrayed. But honestly, none of them really believe him, do they? Even though everything he's ever said has ever come true, right? They still have trouble believing some things that he say are going to happen. He knows about the plot to take him prisoner, to have him killed. He knows that he only has a few short minutes left with his disciples. And so he's trying to impart to them something that's going to help them, something that's going to carry them through. He's explained to them several times that he must be delivered over into the hands of the people. He must be killed. He's explained that to them more than one time. And yet they still don't seem to really understand. They still don't seem to really get it. And I'd like to think, putting myself in the shoes of the disciples, that I would have been able to understand and, you know, just would have said, okay, you're a son of God, you're the rabbi, you're the teacher, of course what you say is going to happen. But God tells us all throughout his word, over and over and over again, what's going to happen when we continue to rebel against him? What's going to happen when we follow his instructions? And it seems like, you know what, we have it written down for us, we know it, but we still don't want to follow it. The disciples had kind of the same thing going on there. The disciples were scared. They were scared when Jesus said, hey, I'm going to leave you. They started arguing, didn't they? They started saying, I mean, even, you know, even Peter says, if I have to die with you, I will die. And that's not the case that happened, is it? So Jesus explained them exactly what's going to happen. He's trying to give them some peace and some comfort, knowing what a few hours ahead of them really, really hold. But before we can get into this, and before we can say, okay, just because the Bible says it means that it's true. If you're trying to witness to a friend, trying to talk about your faith to a friend who doesn't believe in the Bible, then just saying, because the Bible says it, just because Jesus said it, doesn't have a whole lot of weight, does it? You guys run into those conversations, right? I used to have them, you know, pretty regularly in high school and in college, even in college, in the Christian college. It was like, we don't honestly know if the Bible is 100% true, do we? The fact of the matter is, we honestly, we really, really do. Right? Prove that the Bible, everything in the Bible is true, that it is real, that it is fact. Right? A couple of things I just want to give to you here. You might even want to write down some of these names if you want to do some more research. Right? In AD 64, shortly after Jesus' ministry, not that long after that, right? A Roman historian, right? I can't even begin to pronounce his name right, I'm sure. Right? Tacitus, sure, I'll take your word for it, okay? But he's a Roman historian, right? The key to this is he was Roman, right? What did Romans want to do to Christians?
Kill them.
They wanted them gone, right? So the fact that a Roman historian writes historical narratives about Nero, Pontius Pilate, for people in the Bible, right? He writes about Jesus. He writes about Jesus' trial, Jesus' death. He writes about these things as historical facts that actually happened. Right? So this is not found in the Bible. This is found by an outside source that wanted to honestly eradicate Christianity. Wanted to get rid of it. Right? But he still wrote about it. Alright? Alright? A few short years later, this dude by the name of Pliny. Okay? Sure. Alright? But he was a guy who wrote to the Roman government because he was trying to figure out, what can I legally do to these Christians who are all over the place? What can I legally do to them to try and stop them from spreading their message about this guy by the name of Jesus? Alright? Again, a Roman person, not a Jewish person, not a Christian, right? But somebody outside of the Christian faith trying to find a way to eradicate Christians themselves, right? Josephus was a first century historian, right? So that means he wrote historical facts, things that actually happened and can be confirmed, right? He wrote about Christ, he wrote about the miracles that Jesus did. He wrote about his crucifixion, and he even wrote about Jesus appearing after his resurrection. A historian, okay? Records historical facts and accuracy, right? Last couple of things, the Babylonian Talmud, right? Which is basically just writings that they had, historical writings. They lasted anywhere from 70 to 500 AD, so it's a big, long, massive history book, okay? Right? They include the stories of Jesus. They include stories of Pontius Pilate and the trials and all those kinds of things. It's in there, right? And the one I didn't honestly know about before doing some more studying this week, this guy named Lucian, right? They classified him as a satirist, which basically means he wrote comic kind of type things, you know.
And he wasn't a vampire.
So he was not a vampire. That's a good thing to point out there, yes. But he was kind of like a newspaper reporter who would take, you know, people who would take political things of that day and make it into some kind of a funny joke, right? But he wrote regularly about the events of Jesus' life. He wrote regularly about Jesus himself, and he wrote about the crucifixion. He wrote about the trial in a satire way, poking fun at it, poking fun at the Christians, right? So all these people who really had nothing to do with Jesus himself, Roman people, except for Joseph. I think Joseph was a Jewish person, if I can remember right.
Josephus was a Jewish.
So all the other ones though were Roman, and so they were out to get rid of Christianity and that thought, but they still wrote about the events of Jesus' life. So we know that they are true, right? We know that the Bible is actually a true historical document. So therefore, if we go into that. That being said, we can prove that the Bible is true, that Jesus existed. These words are words he actually said, and they have meaning to them. Alright? So, John 14. Somebody want to read this because my throat's getting a little bit dry. Alright? David, why don't you read that for us?
Jesus said to his disciples, "Don't be worried. Have faith in God and faith in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. I won't tell you this unless it is true. I will tell you this unless it is true. I am going there to prepare a place for each of you. After I have done this, I will come back and take you with me. Then we will be together."
Okay. So again, remember, we're in the upper room, the Last Supper. Jesus tells the disciples, "Hey, I'm about to be betrayed. I'm about to be killed. But 3 days later, I'm going to come back." Okay? And the disciples are freaking out, going, "You can't leave us. What am I going to do without you?" So Jesus goes into this discourse where he's trying to give them some hope, trying to give them some security in following him. And basically, what Jesus is saying here, right, this is the first thing in your notes. Jesus has a plan for his followers to be with him forever. Right? Jesus doesn't have just a simple plan. It's not a temporary one. But Jesus has a plan for his followers to be with him for all eternity. Right? Now, if you're one of the disciples, put yourself in their shoes. Again, you're scared because this guy that you've been following every single day for 3 years says, "I'm about to be betrayed and I'm going to be leaving you." Alright? And everything they've put their life into for the last 3 years is about to be torn apart. And Jesus says, hey, I'm going to take to get a place ready for you. And I'm going to come back, and I'm going to get you. And I'm going to take you with me. And we're going to be together. So if you're sitting there shaking in your boots going, what am I going to do? Jesus is gone. And Jesus says, don't worry about it. I'm coming back. And I'm going to be with you. And you're going to be with me forever. He's just trying to take some of that insecurity out of there and give them some peace. Right? Then he goes on to say this. John 14, 4 through 6. Somebody else read that for me, please. Okay, well, thank you.
You know the way to where I'm going. Thomas said, Lord, we do not even know where you are going. How can we know the way? I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus answered. Without me, no one can go to the Father.
Alright. This is the infamous verse that so many people know. John 14, 6. I am the way, and the truth, and the life. Alright? Think about that for a second. Alright? Real quick. Jesus says, I am. All he said was, I am the way. What starts to pop into your head? Give me some examples. I am the way. What do you think? What's he talking about?
GPS.
Okay. A GPS pops in. I mean, I'm the way. I'm the direction that you can follow. Alright? Anyone else?
Path.
Okay, the path. Right? You walk down the path, I walk down it, you're going to be okay. Right? Jesus is saying, I am the way. I am the only way. Notice he doesn't say, I am a way. He says, I am the way. Right? Meaning there's nothing else that you can do except follow me to get to your place with God in heaven. Right? Then he says, not only am I the way, but I am also the truth. Right? You guys ever hear that? People say, what really is truth? I mean, that was said at Jesus' trial. What is truth? Okay? We have a lot of people who believe a lot of things to be true today. Right? But the fact of the matter is most of them are just wrong. Right? They believe that all those things you said earlier, that being a good person, that going to church, that giving lots of money, right? That doing more good than bad. They believe all that as a truth, as a way to be able to get to heaven. And the fact of the matter is, Jesus says, none of that matters. I am the way. I am the truth. And he finishes with, I am the life. Right? I am the one that gives you life. Nothing else, no one else can give you true life except me. Alright? So basically what he's saying, number two there, Jesus' plan for eternal life is only through him. So all those reasons that people have given, we talked about earlier, that people give us, I get to heaven if I do this, if I do that, if I believe this hard enough. And Jesus says, no, it's me and me alone. I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Right? And then the last thing that Jesus says here in this section, right? If you had known me, you would have known the Father, but from now on, you do know him. And you have seen him. Jesus claims here. Right? He claims that he is God. Right? He can back that up, can't he? He's the only one who can. He can back up the fact that he is God. You have seen God because you have seen me. You know God because you know me. I am the Father of one is something he said later on. Right? So basically, what's he saying here for each one of us? Come on. My little thingy will work here. So I'm going to communicate. Even though you're only 3 feet apart, you don't want to communicate. Alright. Number three there, Jesus is the one true Lord. He's the one true God. Alright? Every other God that's ever existed in any other religion has always died, has always perished, has always led to a life of destruction. Jesus is the only one that's alive. Jesus is the only one that's actively in our lives day in and day out. He is the one true Lord. Now I know you guys are in school, and I know you guys really don't like homework. Alright?
How do you know?
Just a hunch that I had, okay? But what I would like you to do, alright? Down here on the bottom of your sheet, there's two simple little things here. One says no fear, one says I am. The I am you can fill in real, real easily. It's just what we just talked about. Okay? John 14, 6 tells us exactly what Jesus said. You can fill it in real easily. Alright? But the no fear section is one of those, honestly guys, I want you to do this. on your own. Okay? So it's not really homework, but it's a little bit of an assignment that I want you to do. I want you to complete when you sit down with God on your own and talk to Him about it. Okay? I want you to sit down with Him and I want you to talk to Him about it. And just put yourself at the disciples' feet at that Last Supper table when Jesus comes in. You may have to get out your Bible and read a little bit of the book of John. Alright? Read that whole section so you really know the story. Alright? And then write down why disciples were not to be afraid, even though they were shaking in their boots. Alright? But I want you to put yourself in their shoes and think about that for a minute. Alright? Why would I be afraid? And then why, through what Jesus has just said, why should I not be afraid? Okay, so that's a little assignment that I want you to do. It's also got some questions on here. Alright? I challenge you. Alright? Take some time over the next couple of days. Don't wait until next week to do this. Do it while it's still fresh. Sometime tomorrow, maybe Friday. Take a few minutes. And I want you just to read over these four questions that are right here. I want you to be honest with yourself with them. And I want you just to answer them. Okay? I want you to answer them. That's between you and that's between you and God. Right? But I want you to answer those. I want you to answer them honestly. When you have some time to sit down, just you and God in a Bible open to John chapter 12, 13, 14. Read that section and then answer those questions.